Good evening, everyone. Thank you all for coming out tonight to the Market Street Gateway project. My name is David Allen. I'm the Deputy City Manager. And you need some sound there? More? Okay. Thank you for taking the time to come out during this busy holiday season. What I'd like to do first off is recognize we have the City Manager here, John Bohanko. From the city staff, we have the project team that has worked as the advisory committee. From Public Works, we have Peter Rice, the Director of Public Works, Mark Nelson, the Director of Parking and Transportation, Dave DeFosis, a project engineer. From Planning Department, we have Juliet Walker. She is our transportation planner. We also have Frank Warkol from the Police Department, and from our Economic Development Department, we have Nancy Carmer. Did I get everybody? Okay. What I'd like to, we're going to turn this over to Dirk Rotenhaus, who's the project manager for RSG. But before I do that, this project is actually a follow-up of a project that began back in the 2008, and it was the impetus of the Economic Development Committee to try to improve that gateway that comes in and feeds our historic downtown and goes past our waterfront and looking to improve these spaces, such as adjacent to the Market Street Extension, where we have potential for parks and a lot of open space. So to that end, the city has been working towards some projects to make those improvements, and that included some stuff over by the Sheraton, where we did some sidewalks and curbing and some pedestrian style lighting, some trees. We also, in 2003, we received a CMAQ grant and did some work on the CMAQ is congestion mitigation and air quality grants from the federal government. And we did some a bike lane and sidewalk between the Michael Soucy Drive and the port. And then last year, we were involved with the Exit 7 project off of the I-95 and did some work with that. So again, the goal of this is to try to incorporate a number of items, such as we have that nice median there. We can do some street trees, plantings in there, do both pedestrian and more ornamental lighting, and really provide a nice entryway into the city. In addition, since this project has started, the city council has adopted several policies, including one that some of you have probably heard of called Complete Streets. And we're working on a bicycle pedestrian master plan, and so the city council has also adopted some bicycle-friendly policies as well as pedestrian-friendly policies. So all of those types of elements are things that we're incorporating into this plan. And again, we're early on in this. We're really looking for some input, but the intent is to have the consulting team bring this out to you, and then we're going to be accepting additional input based on what we're showing you. This presentation will actually be rebroadcast on Channel 22. In addition, you'll be able to find it on the city's web page on the in the YouTube, so you'll be able to find to go back and look at the information provided here, and also the PowerPoint presentation that you'll see, as well as the results of your input, will be on the Plan Portsmouth webpage. So that's www.planportsmouth.com, and all of the information contained in tonight's presentation will be found there. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Dirk, and he can introduce his project team and run through where they are.
Thank you, David. My name is Dirk Rotenhuis with RSG. I'm a civil engineer, also the project manager for the Market Street Gateway Improvement Project. We've got some members of our design team that are here. Todd Richardson with Richardson Associates is one of the landscape architects. Grace Wu from RSG. She's one of the planners. And Josh Tompkins with Richardson Associates is also landscape architecture. So tonight's meeting is really going to unfold in a certain way, and I'd like to just say we're probably going to spend about 45 minutes, maybe to an hour, doing a presentation, kind of a formal presentation with slides. Since this is recorded, we're going to try and keep the questions as minimal as possible because the audience or the video audience won't be able to hear the questions. So if there are some questions that do arise, we're going to try and see if they can have them towards the end. So the first thing we'll go through is really the project background, what led us to this project, and then really the presentation of the concept, which is kind of the meat of this meeting today. We are going to talk about some other considerations, and that's really some things that have come up since the original concepting design. Some things have changed, some uses have changed, and some opportunities have changed throughout this corridor. So we are open to feedback in certain areas. And then this last component would be kind of an open feedback station, and we've got three stations set up through the room. There's one over here that's talking about the gateway identity. That's in the orange. And there's one here in the green is going to talk about a little bit about complete streets. And then there's the parks and open space. So at the end, that's going to be the time we're going to ask people to we're going to stop the formal presentation, but we're going to ask people to go to those stations and provide input. Each one of the design team members will be at one of those stations. That's the area we're going to try and get as much feedback as possible about the concept design that we're presenting tonight. And there are some options. We're about, say, a 20% design, and then we're going to be proceeding after this input session through into a preliminary design stage. So we want to try and get as much input and involvement with the public as possible. So we'll have about 45 minutes to an hour of this presentation, and then maybe 20 minutes as a breakout, and then we'll conclude the complete meeting. A couple of introductory things. As David mentioned, this is not a brand new project. There was a study done in 2008 that identified certain things through this corridor that would be increasing pedestrian movement, trying to get bicycles through this area, increasing streetscaping, adding in some other elements throughout this corridor to really create a gateway. And that set the foundation for our work and where we picked it up, really to just gut check the concept and see if there are other opportunities since 2008. And I think we've identified a couple. We'll go through them. And then we're going through after this 2008 report is really where we're starting right now. So we're starting in 2013 with this project, which is really the design of the project. And during that 2008 input session, there was many public meetings or a few public meetings, and these are just some things that we heard or that were heard through that study. And they're pretty typical comments, but they're specific to this corridor. There's things as far as concerns with screening, and there's concerns with speeding, and there's concerns with a lot of things through that area. There's public there's great waterfront opportunities that aren't taken advantage of yet. So I think there are a lot of things that we learned up until now and that we're going to implement into this plan. So just as really an overall view of the corridor itself, this is running from exit 7, just a little bit west of exit 7, all the way to Russell Street towards the downtown. And our presentation will present itself all the way from this end really sequentially down through to the downtown area. If you're a resident, then you're pretty familiar with these landmarks here. There's a railroad coming through here. I do want to point out that there's this preliminary alignment that is the Sarah Mildred Long Bridge alignment that will be relocated. So that's as much as we know. I mean, we know DOT is going through the design right now, so this is kind of the latest information. There might be some more updates that will be coming forward on it. As David also mentioned, the city's also done some other things in this corridor, citywide, that relate to this corridor, and that's the wayfinding project, and that's underway and almost complete, and that will provide direction and signage for people entering the area, as well as exiting to find out destinations, and that's both vehicle and pedestrian wayfinding, as well as the bike and pedestrian master plan. That's just beginning. So in this corridor, we're looking at both adding some bicycle lanes, some bicycle facilities, as well as enhancing the pedestrian. And then I mentioned the Sarah Long Bridge construction. There are some opportunities with this. It's going to be a much sleeker bridge design. It's going to be very well open. So the feel within Market Street is going to change just by the DOT putting a new bridge in there. So it won't look like this for much longer. Well, some people think it will be long. It'll take a while to build that bridge, let me put it that way. And then through this corridor, there are very unique conditions. And there are opportunities in those that we want to look at and we want to take advantage of. At the beginning of this corridor, it's kind of what we're terming as the ledges. There's a large outcrop of rock right at exit 7 as you come off. There's some opportunities there that Todd will go through and explain a little bit more that will help give a sense, or potentially give a sense, to you're entering into a different area. You're getting away from, you know, the highway, the interstate feel, getting into a little bit more human-scaled area. And then the waterfront, like I mentioned, it's very underutilized right now. We'd love to get some more access to that, better access, maybe even just views, viewscapes through that area as you're driving down the road. We do know there's a bit of vegetation that blocks some of the view of the water. That would be great if we can manage that. And in our concept, we've included a park along the waterfront. So that would be a great opportunity. Sarah Long Bridge will change that feel, but also we also want to embrace some of the uses that are along that corridor and that will continue along that corridor. So we want to make sure that we're doing that in a holistic way, making sure we're looking at the whole corridor, but also recognizing that there are a lot of users in this corridor. One of the areas that we can look at is this how we wayfind people through the corridor. And this is just a preliminary look at what a sign would be going down this down Market Street, Chamber of Commerce building on the right. And we'd love to add a little bit more, there's not a lot of trees out there. Median's a lot of concrete. So to introduce planting, soften things up through this corridor would be a really key to this plan. And then adding some period lighting. The city has recognized that there are areas that really need better lighting and make it, you know, in a historic flavor. So something similar to that's on the Scammell Bridge, that's in Dover. But it'd be great if we could introduce these, and we will introduce this type of lighting through the corridor. It has great opportunities for art. There are some places along the corridor, whether it's art for a competition or whether it's programmed art throughout the year. There's areas within the median. There's areas within the park. There's actually going to be two parks to this. So there are great areas that could be utilized for it. And we talk about complete streets. Well, a complete street really is a street for all users. That's the basic term of it. All modes of traffic, all modes of transportation, so bike, ped, pedestrians, vehicles, they're still considered. So we have to make sure that we can move them through the corridor without huge delays. We want to make sure that we're getting people safely to their destinations. Here's just a couple of baseline information here. There's 15,000 vehicles on an average weekday. And during the peak hour, you can see there the AM is 900 vehicles and the PM is 1,100 vehicles. The average speed through here is 43 miles an hour. And we mentioned this 85 percentile. That's actually what we typically benchmark as the high end of a speed limit when we're doing posting. And does anybody know what this is posted for? 35 miles an hour. So the speeds are high. We want to try and address that. We want to try and slow the traffic down a bit, but still getting proper flow so the vehicles can get through this corridor without much delay, but not as fast. There are trucks in this corridor. There's users that come on and off this public right-of-way that are adjacent to this corridor that will continue to, and we need to make accommodations for that to an extent that, you know, we want to be able to get people safely around. So it is the primary route from the New Hampshire port to Interstate I-95. So that's a pretty critical route for goods coming in and out of the city and in and out of the port. So it's a critical connection. There's 5% of the traffic is single unit vehicles, and I just term that as that have kind of two axles, like a school bus would be determined at UPS delivery vehicle would be determined a single unit. So there's 5% of the traffic out there are those type of vehicles. And 2% are really the tractor trailers, the larger trucks. Along with some of the complete streets, theory here is that we want to make sure that we're getting pedestrians safely to where they want to, but not only safely, but feeling better about where they're walking, not walking right adjacent to a 43 mile an hour car at all times. So that's just not a really comfortable feeling for most pedestrians. And I'd say it's the exact same feeling you get when you're riding a bicycle. If you were riding a bicycle through here, it's not a really comfortable corridor. You're really very experienced or just need to get transportation through this corridor. And all you have is a bicycle. So we want to try and reduce the traffic stress that that people have when they're riding bicycles through this. So we're going to be introducing shared lanes. That means lanes with vehicles and pedestrians and bicycles, as well as bike lanes, dedicated bike lanes with signals or with symbols. And then there are some transit users. There's some bus stops along this route, so we want to make sure that we're looking at how people could get to those, and as well as how the buses could pull off and pick up. And so the corridor in a whole, we do want to get it to a sense of an arrival place being the downtown area. And so we've looked at this in kind of sequentially, as I mentioned, there's ledges, there's out by I-95, and then kind of the riverfront, waterfront areas that we want to look at. We've got a park planned in here, and then a park planned in here. And Todd will go through that in just a second. But also want to just make sure that we're embracing all users in this corridor. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Todd, and he'll step you through the actual concepts and have some discussion on that.
Thank you, Derek, and good evening. Just wanted to begin by talking a little bit about the distance from the area out here to the west, all the way into here, headed towards Market Square, and the distance is almost a mile. So there's a lot of opportunity in the mile that Dirk has begun to allude to. I'm going to talk about it in sections. We're going to start by talking from the west. This is the 295 or the 95 corridor here, Market Street, coming in. So there's the western section, the central section, and then the eastern section, and we'll walk through those. Dirk also mentioned the importance of the overall corridor being unified and thought of as one place. So we're going to tease it apart by talking about it geographically from west to east. And we'll start on the western side, that is the underpass and on and off ramps coming off of of 95 down onto Market Street itself. I'm going to use a number of graphic tools to describe the intent and the content of the plan. We're going to be looking down on it in plan view. We'll also have some cross sections and other tools that I'll show you in just a minute. But what I wanted to do is start with some of the specifics of the graphics. So in the plans, you're seeing where there's signals. These green circles are indicative of street trees that are proposed within the corridor itself. These black symbols here are for the lighting, and I'll talk more specifically about the role of lighting the corridor for vehicles and lighting the corridor for pedestrians. You'll see throughout the presentation this evening some of these rectangular forms. Those are components of the overall plan, and our plan overlaps with some work that's happening with the wayfinding project. So directional signage, identity signage, and things like that are indicated here. And then the importance of the integration of multimodal transportation and the incorporation of bus stops, trolley stops along the corridor. So we'll also look at lanes specifically and different sidewalk conditions throughout the corridor as well. So we'll start with looking down on it. And then specifically with the graphics that we're using here, at the very top, this is the whole corridor, this light brown. And red, indicated right there, is where a cross-section or a slice through the corridor is being depicted. And then below that here is a section of the Market Street corridor looking down on it. And in all cases, the blue cars are inbound. They're coming off of 95 into the city. And then the white cars are the outbound vehicles. And then the black here is indicative of what you see in the section here, but in plan view. And we've indicated where there's through lanes and then also turning lanes at specific locations. So this one is taken west of 95. That white line there is 95 passing overhead. So you can see in this particular circumstance, we're integrating some street trees in the median where there are no street trees right now, taking that opportunity in hand. On this northern side of the corridor itself, there's a new decorative ornamental street lights with an automobile scale head on it, as well as a pedestrian scale head here. We're seeing what are called sharrows, which are indicated with this symbol in the plan view on both sides here. And those are lanes that are shared both by automobiles and bicyclists. So the lane widths are a little wider there. You can see in plan view and also by the numbers that are indicated up above in the section. So a sharrow lane coming in to the city and out to the city there. And in this case, on the northbound side, we have a sidewalk that comes in and under the bridge headed towards the city. This next section is moving a little further down, and we're still before the bridge. So graphically, in plan view, you can see this is taken right at the section where I described the bridge coming over. And here's the bridge. So this is the abutment on either side and the bridge coming over the top there. And you can see the inbound lanes here. There are two turn lanes that exist now, two through lanes, and then the sharrows, the shared lane with a bicycle and car, both inbound and outbound at this particular location. There's discussion of public art in the corridor, and one opportunity that we're intrigued by and I'm curious to get your thoughts on this evening is the opportunity for using an area under the bridge itself for potentially some creative expression. And we found two examples that began to depict this, one in Philadelphia here, and this one in Chicago, where this is kind of a community tile work here. It's a little more graphic, but it takes a space under a bridge that's typically dark and makes it into some type of opportunity. So we're not suggesting either of these are the right fit, but wanted to come forward looking at this as a unique opportunity under the underpass. Dirk had mentioned the ledges. The top images here are on the north side, and these are on the south side. The north side is a little bit more prevalent. That ledge was blasted for the construction of Market Street and the interchange there. And on the south side, in a nice way, hidden behind some of the vegetation are these wonderful natural ledges that exist there. And as one of the first aspects of the corridor coming into the city from 95, some early thinking is to expose the ledge on the south side and potentially incorporate some type of subtle lighting that would illuminate these features as you come into the city, so reveal them and illuminate them. Moving further to the west from the east, this is up towards the church. And again, we're heading inbound in the right lane, outbound here. And one of the things that I want to bring up here is that we have a designated bike lane now on both sides, outbound and inbound. You can see the automobile scale lighting on both sides. Here is the pedestrian scale lighting there. And then we have a multi-purpose 10-foot wide pathway that comes down the corridor now. So we're introducing something that's very pedestrian friendly and an opportunity for people that want to walk the corridor itself. Taking advantage of the median strip, you can see in plan view some of the proposed trees. So street trees on both sides as well as the median really changes the scale of the corridor right now, which is quite open and quite an extent of pavement. So this will bring a change in scale, an aesthetic improvement. It will also add some shade to the corridor, which is often hot in the summer months. It was mentioned earlier that the whole corridor is really seen as a gateway into the city, and that there are multiple segments of the corridor that offer opportunities to talk to or speak to the character and quality of the city. One unique one is out towards 95, where the idea of having some type of gateway sign, some way of formally welcoming people into the city. And I want to start with this middle item right here, which is really important in our view, is that whatever we do here at this gateway sign would really be expressive of the city itself. It would be of the city, and so distinctive and specific to the city of Portsmouth. We talked about the creative arts and public art, so it might be artistic in the way it's depicted. It would be determined as more of a functional art than just a piece of sculpture. Ideally, it serves as some type of landmark, so people traveling to the city, arriving at the city, might refer to this specific entry sign or gateway in a landmark type way. Our thinking would be that it would reflect and be rooted in the history, but also forward thinking, as we feel the city is. It would be of the landscape scale and not just a small little object in the landscape, but we would think it would be noteworthy in that landmark quality and create a strong statement. So this is the beginning of the corridor. Here's 95. So I'm going to present three concepts that we've been thinking about and I'm curious to get your input on this evening that would occur in this general area. The first one capitalizes on the median, the beginning of the median. So this is the off-ramp if you're coming northbound, and this is the on-ramp going northbound. So the 95 is here, so coming under. So the idea with this particular strategy or approach is that it's linear and it occurs within the median. So it might be something that would be repetitive in either a sculptural fashion. It might include granite. It might include elements that would withstand being in the central corridor there. An advantage of this particular strategy is that it's both related to coming into the city and exiting the city. So this would be the location for this suggested option A, which would be linear and in the center median. The second one, which is reflected in the purple here, is another idea where this gateway itself might actually form some type of gate. So linking to the ledges on the south side, linking to the ledges on the north, and carrying across, including an element that might occur in the median. So this is really perpendicular to the flow of traffic, which is different from the first one, which would be parallel to it. And both the first option and this second one occur up here, right at this intersection. The next option, the third one, occurs back a little further, as indicated by these three bands right here. And this one is a little different in we're thinking that there might be some type of large sign or element here, but plantings might come across and occupy these three areas coming across here. So instead of something linear or crossing, this is more of an area, and we might think that plants along with an identification sign might be indicative of what this third option would entail. Just quickly, a few images to the idea that it's rooted in the history. You know, it might be reflective of some of the past and some of the industrial roots, the connection to the river, and then certainly the arts that are alive here in Portsmouth. So moving on to the central portion of the corridor, and this is very distinguished in that there's a new park opportunity that Dirk had talked to, and this is the North Mill Pond in here. So there's some really interesting landscape qualities and characteristics here. This is also the place where the Sarah Long Bridge comes over in this location. One of the things that happens in this particular section, the middle section, is that the lights move to the middle here, and I'll show you that in the sections and the plans of the roadway itself. And then the Riverfront Park here, and I'll talk more specifically about that. You can see that here are some of the sign and the transit stops that are suggested, and we're investigating with Coast. So this new park really offers a great opportunity to gain access to the waterfront. It's notable in its size. I'm sure you've driven by it many times and know the area I'm talking about. One of the things that we're proposing is that in addition to the walkway that would allow direct access along the edge of Market Street, there'll also be a pathway that comes into the park here. What you're looking at are a series of open lawn areas here with native vegetation that would be indicative of what would grow along the shore. And one of the things that's proposed that's unique to this middle section is that the type of landscape treatment that we're proposing for the park actually comes and occupies both the median and potentially capitalizing on some of the adjacent areas on the southbound. So this whole area has a different treatment in terms of vegetation, trees and shrubs that would occupy it, and it's reflective of the park and the notion of the park being adjacent to the waterfront here. There's a proposed kiosk area here for directional information, and people may cross at the crosswalk here and come into the park. Difficult to see, but there's some benches that are located here for great views of the water, this immediate area, and then the river beyond. There's a different type of lighting that's proposed in here that's different from the lighting of the corridor itself. So again, at the top, this is the overall view. You can see we've started moving down the corridor towards the city here. So the section is taken right through here. Here's the water. So you can see the embankment coming up, and here is that new park. And along the pathway that begins to move into the park, or along the Market Street, I'm sorry, here, the sidewalk, there's a pedestrian scale light. There's the centralized light in the median. And we're suggesting this because, as people know, the riprap and the water over towards the mill pond are quite close there. So we relocate the light there. There's a different type of lighting, low-level illumination within the park itself. These bollards here would illuminate the walkways so people feel comfortable and safe moving through it. But the park is fairly open with great water views. And here you can see the continuation of the dedicated bike lanes in both directions. Here's the multi-purpose, the 10-foot wide multi-purpose path, the light in the middle, and then the pedestrian light illustrated right there above. This is just for your reference, Market Street coming here. This is an earlier depiction of the Sarah Long Bridge. It's changed since then, I think, slightly. This is the corridor that suggested coming over from Kittery, so you can see the current location of the bridge here. It moves just a bit to the west here. And we're excited about the new configuration where it's more open underneath here. We're considering the possibility of maybe underlighting some aspects of the bridge here, the supports and the structural components of it, to kind of celebrate that unique structure that will be bringing new identity to the city in this particular area. And then moving west further towards the city, here we can see the centralized light. We're further down in the corridor here. the bike lanes on either side, again, the pedestrian scale lighting there, and the vegetation that's different in the core on the median there, which is quite wide at this particular location. So you can see in plan view, inbound, the dedicated bike lanes, a turn lane, two through lanes, and two through lanes there. Here we can see just before the bridge itself, again, similar treatment, the centralized light fixture. We're seeing the repetition of the continued dedicated bike lanes, turn lanes coming outbound, and two dedicated lanes for inbound traffic. Moving to the east, we have some unique opportunities in this particular area of the corridor. One that people may recall from the earlier study is the overlook condition here. And so connected back to the corridor here, there'd be pedestrian access over to a really exciting opportunity to look at all the activity that's occurring on the river itself. There's also another unique aspect, which is a small mill pond open space, small park that's occurring here. And you can see in plan view, again, some of the signs, some of the transit stops. This is intended to provide some buffering from some of the uses that are occurring adjacent here, and then capitalizing on that median again with some of the street trees that would help to bring scale and shade to this section of the corridor. And again, we're headed inbound to the city. You can see that we're further down. Here's the North Mill Pond. Here's this small park condition. We can see the pedestrian head connected to the automobile light fixture on this particular side. That's repeated on the north side as well. But you can see continuation of the dedicated bike lanes, in this case lanes coming in with a turning lane and two lanes outbound as well. We tried to incorporate some similar themes in regards to unifying the two different new open space conditions, the curved path coming through, vegetation that would be seen along a coastal condition such as this, opportunities for gathering, opportunities for sitting, as well as potentially some interpretive opportunities for the uniqueness of the mill pond itself. I'm going to hand it back to Dirk, who's going to walk you through some other considerations before we open it up for the individual breakout sessions.
So through the corridor, we looked at other things we could do within a complete street. And we wanted to make sure we're exploring a lot of different opportunities, a lot of options through this. And so as a part of Complete Streets, we looked at what's called a road diet. And a road diet would be eliminating a vehicle travel lane. And there are conditions which could warrant that. And in this case, with the Market Street, we've done some traffic analysis, and it is an opportunity there that it could occur. It's something that we're going to explore, but there's other aspects to the project that we want to make sure it's in keeping and in fitting. So one of the things, a road diet, and if we eliminate a vehicle lane, could provide, and that's some opportunities for other uses within the corridor. And those other uses could be the bicycles, the pedestrians, the landscaping, bringing things down into a smaller corridor area that makes people slow down a little bit. And it restricts people's thinking that there's this wide, vast, open pavement feel out there to go faster. So we want to try and calm traffic. And this is one method. There are other methods of trying to do that. So depending on levels of services and some other things in a traffic sense, there are some opportunities that we are going to be exploring. This isn't to be said that we're going to be doing it, but we're at a pretty early stage that we want to just make sure that we're considering it. And so here, just as an example, and this is just an example of What could occur is that there would be one inbound lane and one outbound lane. And we've done some analysis that shows that that could be done with minimal delays. But it could mean that there's opportunities to have two lanes outbound and one inbound, and opening up some different ways of viewing this whole area. And some of those opportunities, you know, they could be multi-use paths, like I mentioned, some landscaping, cycle track. That's just a cycle track is a high level of for bicyclists. It allows them very comfortable, very safe, and you know, it really goes down to even you know, a children's scale being of safety through that. So there are opportunities that could gain some of these elements within a road diet. But these are, regardless, any complete streets should include these, and our project will. You know, we are having bicycle lanes. That's what we're proposing in this concept, as well as some shared lanes. And just a little bit of background information. Again, I'm an engineer, so I like numbers. Just interesting that I wanted to plot out really what the traffic is in the corridor. And you know, to no surprise, this red line is eastbound in, and then the blue is westbound out. I guess we should have coordinated that with the color of the vehicles, but we didn't do that. So in the morning, you know, people coming into town, and this is the time of that. 7 o'clock is about the peak, and then it kind of tapers off through the midday, and then towards the end, still people coming in, and then it just tapers off. And outbound, you see the peak at the PM exiting. So these are things we want to just make sure that we're. Go ahead. The question was, what time of year was this? This was October, where it was. Yeah, we collected data over the full October, or two weeks in October, which was, there was one weekend that there was a holiday in there, so we did collect over a pretty peak season, and we understand that there are other times of the year that traffic changes in Portsmouth. Fall is a pretty peak season too. There's a lot of visitors, as well as during the summer. So I think we captured a pretty good idea of when that peak occurs. So another thing, when we're looking at what affects lane reductions or even just traffic in a sense, is how much delay there is to people at intersections. And that's really just a measurement of how long people sit at a red light. And if we removed a lane in either direction or both directions, we call this a level of service, which just is a grade from A to F, and that's how the intersection is operating. C is pretty normal, it's an average. So if you have an A or a B, you're doing really good. If you have a C, it's pretty much normal. So there's very limited increase in both the level of service and then the delay, that's in seconds. So Market Street, Michael Soucy, if you're trying to get out of Michael Soucy, you're going to average delay would be 11 seconds. And I want to point out, this is accelerated into the future. This is in 2024. So we take a look at existing condition in 2014, and then we project the traffic out for any growth out to 10 years. So we do, yes?
Have you taken into consideration the proposed development in the north end of Portsmouth that's going to increase traffic coming into Portsmouth?
Yes. Yep. We met with the planning department, and we went through all of the projected, as permitted as well as projected developments in the northern tier to make sure we have those incorporated into our traffic analysis. Yes. So right now it's operating very well. Whether we, as far as the vehicle delays through that corridor, you probably have 3, 4, at the most maybe 5 vehicles stacking at a light signal, and then on they go. Well, no, not during a peak hour. The peak hour you would have higher than that. Agreed.
Most
So those are just opportunities that we want to be exploring through our design. So we want to be cognizant of all modes of traffic through there, all modes, it's both vehicles, trucks, pedestrians, bicyclists, transit. So we want to make sure we're taking all into that consideration. So that concludes the public presentation, or our overall presentation. Oh, sorry. Yes, we do have that. No, I'm not done yet. That's right. So, as I mentioned, we are going to break out into some feedback stations. So that's when we'd love to get more information from you. And as I mentioned, there's this Market Street identity. That's one of the boards that are up. Parks and open space. And then complete streets. So this is where we can get a lot of good feedback. We really want that feedback on all of these elements. And anything else that you notice through this that you know, maybe we haven't presented, there's some other ideas, we'd love to hear those.
I really like what I've seen. My biggest thought is that you're not going quite far enough. There's an awful lot of people who live in Atlantic Heights, Spinnaker Point, and you know, Osprey Landing, and in the areas up off of Maplewood, and you go underneath the bridge, and I can tell you from walking down there, it's really dark down there, particularly the stretch between Spinnaker Point and Portsmouth Boulevard. So the city could find it. It's hard to extend some of those lights along there. It would help a lot, and also. That part of town, I think, probably has more handicapped people who are, you know, in small mobility vehicles than really any place else in the city. And that stretch of parking lot from, you know, a lot of it was improved when they redid the Exit 7 area. But it does break down as you get up past Spinnaker Point, which I think would be a problem for people in mobility vehicles. I would think all this, you know, the nice park lines and everything would encourage them to try and get down there. And that sidewalk is going to be a barrier. And the Exit 7 south off-ramp is a barrier. Because unfortunately, even with the traffic lights and signalization that they've got, people don't stop for the right, you know, the right turn on red. They don't stop.
Right, right.
So, you know, things that, if those things could be added to it, I'd be just a real happy.
Yeah, if I could just take an opportunity to respond to that. You know, this is, like I had mentioned before, we actually started doing little pieces. We did a piece down in front of the Sheraton. We did the Exit 7. We've done some other things. And I think, you know, you have to start somewhere. I think what we're going to come up with is a good design here that people are comfortable with. And this could be the model for other areas, too. But and your point is well taken that, you know, things don't end when this project stops, and obviously the city continues to make improvements, and your comments are, you know, they're heard, and obviously we would like to be able to expand the project. Currently, under what we have budgeted and what we have planned, this project has those limits, but obviously there are great opportunities to move that forward.
So,
okay, yeah, so really, you know, the way this was set up is that you're going to go to these breakout sessions, and they're going to put your comments, record those comments, and one of the things that we're going to be able to do is we're going to put that together in a report. Those are going to be online, and so you'll be able to, if you don't get a chance to get to every station, you'll certainly get a chance to see what those comments are, but really take the time to get to any of these stations where you feel you have some input.
And Dirk's going to do the online tool.
Oh, yeah, why don't you?
Yeah, so, thanks, David.
I have a question. What? As far as process is concerned, we're going to be breaking up into groups, and these three items. And we're going to travel from one route to the other?
No, the plan is to visit the station that you would like to visit. Yeah, and then provide input. So there isn't a scheduled presentation after this presentation of that material. It's
right.
More.
I guess what I'm asking is, after we break up into these groups, is there a regathering where these ideas can be presented and exchanged? Yeah. Is there ongoing consideration that some of us have come here for? Where will we have a chance to address those to the group as large?
Did you want?
Yeah,
the board
I
doesn't care. As long as you put it on the board, they take it into consideration.
What was that?
The intent is to get this information. You know, as we said, this is we're very early on in this process. They're gathering this input right now. They'll be putting that together, putting a report online. There will be follow-up meetings after this meeting. I mean, this is the information gathering. They're going to have to digest that, come together with some additional concepts, and there will be a follow-up meeting.
There will be subsequent. Yeah.
Oh, absolutely, yes. Absolutely, yes.
Right.
Yeah. So it really, other than the Dirk doing the overview, there's a web input that he's going to present to you, and then we'll go right into those breakout sessions.
So online on planportsmouth.com, we're just setting it up for tomorrow, that there'll be a live web tool, and you can access it right through the website. This web tool is fairly easy, but this is a place where you can sit at home after you've thought about some of this, or some of the viewers, if they have a place to, they'd like to leave a comment. It's pretty easy. You just need to register, and then you just sign in like you would basically any other website. And you can put a comment card or a comment anywhere on the site. And if you have some concerns of, say, the waterfront, you can post a mark there and make a comment. And everybody, it's an open source. Everybody can see those comments. So it's actually helps that you see other people's comments, and then you can make your comments on those comments. So it's actually a pretty interactive way to go ahead and try and get information. I can go through a quick tutorial, but it is pretty basic that you can just go online and click on the bottom of the Portsmouth webpage for setup for the Market Street Gateway. This is the project page, and down at the bottom there'll be a link. And that will put you to this page. And this is really just a place that you can share your thoughts about the project. And we'll be collecting this over a period of 30 days. So a month, this will be open for anybody to log on and make some comments. You can zoom in, you can zoom out. We have the concept plan overlaid onto a Google map so that you can kind of surf around and check out the concept plan that we presented tonight. So what's next? Well, where are we? We're at the public engagement, and as the gentleman in the front mentioned, we are going to be going through, we'll be going through this review period of getting some of the comments and incorporating them into an updated design, and then presenting that again at a preliminary design. So we'll be stepping into a preliminary design after that, and then final design, and then this project will be constructed. So that's really the impetus of this. Let's get things into the ground. Let's get things the right way. And so at the end of this project, we'll have a contractor working to make these improvements.
What's the timeline?
The timeline for this right now is we're completing our initial process within by mid-January. This public engagement process, mid to end of January, and then we'll be going right into a preliminary design, which would probably be 2 to 3 months, and then another few months for the final design. So we are talking towards the end of summer, fall next year of going out for bids. So.
How is this being funded?
The question is, how is this being funded? This is being funded by a CIP, so a capital improvement plan. There's been funding that's been set aside for this project.
So the residents of the city of Portsmouth pay for
That's correct.
And how is this impacting the property taxes?
An engineer, I'm not sure how the property taxes are going to be affected by this. There's a lot of officials here that I'm sure that if you grab them afterwards, they'll be able to answer that. I do want to leave you with this. Nancy Carmer is the point person for contacting. So if you have any specific things after this meeting that you can't get addressed through the web tool or any of the other staff, please get in touch with Nancy. She'll get in touch with us and let us know the concerns. So that concludes this portion of the presentation.